thank the organizers for the invitation to deliver this talk. And as you see from the title, the title is Dynamics Around the Binary Asteroid Part 1. And the reason for Part 1 is that in the afternoon, Professor Katalin Galesh will deliver the second part of this talk about dynamics around binary asteroids, which refers to a recent work in collaboration with Jaime Burgos Garcia, Marian Guidea, and Weiling Tam, Lam, beside Katalin and myself. So we had a paper with these colleagues, and we are keeping working with them. That will also show at the end the references. There is a previous paper by Burgos Garcia and Guidea, which gave rise to these works. So the scheme of this lecture is the following. I will first give an introduction to the subject, and then I will introduce central configurations. Now, central configurations are extremely important in this kind of talks. Everybody knows the famous Lagrangian, Euler-Lagrangian configurations, but I would like to generalize, as we did in this paper. And afterwards, I will give I will switch to another topic, which is the geopotential expansion, which is also important for our goals. And here I would like to spend, given also the kind of audience that we have within Stardust, I would like to give different notions of the geopotential expansions. And then we will start giving the four-body problem with the dynamics of the four-body problem in the general case where we have oblate primaries. Please keep in mind this, because we will not just retain point mass bodies, but we will consider oblate primaries. So to do this, we will need to go back to three bodies. As you see, we go back and forth between four and three bodies. But we will set up which is the motion of the three primaries. It will be on a central configuration. We will give the location of the three bodies in the triangular central configurations. And then finally, we will give the motion, the Hamiltonian, of the four-body problem with oblate primaries. And this will be the starting place from which Katalin will follow, will continue with this lecture. So the aim of the talk will be, the overall aim will be to give a dynamical characterization of asteroids in binary system, and this is this enters a four-body problem, because we have the two binary systems, the asteroid and its companion, and then we have, for example, Jupiter and Sun. So we have a four-body problem. But of course, we can generalize this to different settings. For example, we can consider a spacecraft which moves around an asteroid. So it is a very timely topic in view of space missions. So we have a spacecraft, the asteroid, and then we have Sun and Jupiter. So we can also think about this kind of four-body problem with an artificial object instead of a natural object like the companion or the asteroid. And then the other point that I was already mentioning before is that we want to try to study a realistic perturbation. Realistic perturbation means to have oblateness of the primaries and not just point mass bodies. The motivation will be that we want to determine the triangular, there are two motivations, let's say. One is from the theoretical point of view, and the other one is on applications, as it often happens in celestial mechanics. So you just don't have one motivation which is theoretical and the other one is applicative, but the two combine together. So we will need to determine triangular central configurations with oblate bodies. This is the more theoretical part. But of course, we keep an eye on possible applications. For example, I just mentioned here that NASA is preparing the first mission Lucy to Jupiter's Trojans, and you know much more about this. Okay, so binary asteroids. Binary asteroids, as I mentioned before, imply to consider a system formed by four bodies. And the four bodies are the two asteroids, Sun and Jupiter. A relevant role is played by those models in which the three major bodies lie on a triangular central configuration. So, for example, we have Sun, Jupiter, and an asteroid which is located closer to the Lagrangian equilibrium points. However, we are well aware of the fact that asteroids have very often very regular shapes. So it is useful to assume in our model that at least the smaller body is oblate, even better if we can assume that also the other two bodies will be oblate. I will, as I mentioned before, I will concentrate on the setup of the equilibrium of the of the Hamiltonian of the equations of motion of this four-body problem, and from there we can derive several other conclusions, among which the existence of equilibrium points and the corresponding linear stability analysis, which will be considered, if I'm not wrong, in the second part by Katalin Galesh. Okay, so next, we will consider a specific asteroid, as we did in the paper with Burgos Garcia, Guidea, and Lam. And the asteroid will be Hector, which is located close to the point L4 of Sun Jupiter system. And we will consider this binary asteroid with its small moonlet Scamandros. Now, Hector is the largest Jupiter Trojan. It has an elongated shape, as I will show later some pictures, reconstructions of its shape, and its moonlet Scamandros appears also to have a quite complex shape. It is close to a 1:10 or 2:21 orbit spin resonance, so a small change could potentially eject at the moonlet or make it collide with the asteroid. So it is interesting to, in this respect, it is obviously interesting to try to understand the dynamics of this four-body problem with these two binary asteroids. What about the primaries? The primaries will be Sun, Jupiter, Hector, and we will give a hierarchy of masses here, because M1 is the mass, we'll denote from M1 the mass of the Sun, which is greater or equal than the mass of Jupiter, M2, which is much greater than the mass of Hector, M3. We assume that they move on circular orbits under the mutual gravity, and that they will form a triangular central configuration. But here, some more notions about central configurations will be needed, because they will not be the standard triangular equilateral central configuration that we are typically led to consider. That is, we are all well aware that this is the picture from above of the solar system, and we are aware that there are two triangular central configurations. I try to design them with a mouse. Can you see it?
Yes.
Okay. So this was to understand also if the rest of the world was there. It is these virtual talks feel us a little bit distant from the people, from the listeners. So please also interrupt me if you have questions, and this would be very nice from your side. So we have the typical triangular equilateral configurations are Sun, Jupiter, and then we make an equilateral triangle, and we see that there are two camps. One is Trojan and Greek camps, and there are clouds of Trojans around the exact equilateral triangular configurations. As you know, the Trojans are following Jupiter, the Greeks are going ahead of Jupiter because they are the winners, and so on. So, which are the largest Jupiter Trojans? This is a list, both of Greek and Trojan camps, and you see that Hector, with an average diameter of 225 kilometers, is the largest one, followed by Patroclus, Agamemnon, and so on, and the diameters are between 100 and 200 kilometers of diameters. So that we have different bodies, and we take the largest one. So it is time to introduce you this asteroid with some pictures. And of course, if we take a picture of the asteroid, it becomes just a dot. Because in this, as in the left panel, which is an 8-minute exposure on Jupiter Trojan Hector, taken with the apparent magnitude of 15, and it is an image which was taken at in 2009. On the right side, instead, in the right panel, we have a reconstruction of the three-dimensional model of Hector from a light curve. And you can see here that the shape is far from being a spherical shape. So this is one point that I want to underline since now. Before going on with Hector, let me say that this is what about Jupiter binary Trojans? So now we speak of binary Trojans. This is a list of binary Trojans with candidate binaries, which with unconfirmed status displayed on a darker background. You see that the major two are Patroclus and Hector with their companions, which are Menetius and Scamandrios. And as I mentioned it before, the shape of Hector is far from being a spherical one, but this is common to many asteroids because I put here asteroids with irregular shapes, and here you can find the picture of Itokawa, Eden Dactyl, double asteroid, and Bennu. So we have far from being a regular shape, we have dumbbell asteroids, ellipsoidal asteroids, and irregular shapes. Why do we want to focus on the study of asteroids? Okay, so this, this is a question that could have several hours of answer. Let me just give a motivation to say that the questions to study asteroids are several. Their composition helps to study the evolution of the solar system. They can be composed by interesting materials. They can be used also as natural spacecraft to wander within the solar system. And of course, the study of potential impacting asteroids might be of paramount importance for eventual collisions with the Earth, and therefore for the survival of humankind. And this is one of the hot topics which is studied in Stardust Star. Nevertheless, I want to say which are the goals in our case, in this lecture and the following one. We want to describe the gravitational potential, first of all, in terms of second order zonal harmonics. So now we enter a little bit more in the mathematical and the celestial mechanic part. So we will retain the gravitational potential with a potential which will truncate it to second order zonal harmonic. What this means will be clear in a moment. I will give more details, as well as I will give more details on the fact that we will consider triangular central configurations, but, and here comes the surprise, the triangular central configurations will not be done, will not be just an equilateral triangular central configurations, but rather we will have a scalene triangular configuration. So the triangle will not necessarily be an equilateral one, and I will give plenty of details on this. Moreover, triangles corresponding to different values of the moments of inertia, a quantity that I will introduce later, which depends on the norm of the distances, are in general not similar to one another. We will recover the equilateral triangular central configuration when the oblateness of the three primary bodies are set to zero. Next, let me say that the problem that we will consider is the Hector-Scamandrios system, where Scamandrios will be the fourth body, of infinitesimal mass, moving in the vicinity of Hector and under the influence of Sun, Jupiter, and Hector. But it will not affect the motion of the primaries, so we will speak of a restricted problem. And we will consider the motion of this small body in the three-dimensional space, because we will see that its inclination is not at all negligible, while Sun, Jupiter, Hector will move on the same plane and under circular orbits. So this problem is referred to as the spatial circular restricted four-body problem, and can be described, as we will see in the last slide, by an autonomous Hamiltonian with 3 degrees of freedom. So this is the overall scheme of my presentation. And now, if there are no questions, we can switch to the topic of central configurations. So I will first give an introduction to this topic on a broad for a broad audience, and then I will later on I will introduce central configurations with the three oblate bodies. But first, I would like to make things clear and give the definition of what is a central configuration. And this, for this, I refer to this definition that is given in a page, a nice page by Rick Mekela, which can be found on Scholarpedia. So a central configuration is a special arrangement of point masses interacting by Newton's law of gravitation and having the following property. The gravitational acceleration, say, qi double dot, the gravitational acceleration vector produced on each mass, qi double dot, by all others should point toward the center of mass and be proportional to the distance to the center of mass. So we have two requirements. It should point to the center of mass and be proportional to the distance of the center of mass. Next slide, this one, will exactly make explicit this requirements of central, this definition of central configuration by saying that they will point to the center of mass. In fact, it will be gravitational acceleration vector on each mass will be proportional to the distance. See, it will be the center of mass and through a factor lambda and will point to the center of mass. But let me come back to before arriving to that equation, we need to say that the forces which act on each mass Mi are given by the standard Newton's law. So the forces Fi are given by minus the sum over J from 1 to N, with J different from I, of G, G is the gravitational constant, times Mi Mj, Qi minus Qj over Rij cube, where Qj are the position vectors and Rij are the distances Qi minus Qj. Next, we can write Fi as the gradient over I of a potential V, where gradient I is the vector of partial derivatives with respect to the components of Qi, and V is the potential, the sum of G and Mij over Rij. Now, what is the central configuration? According to the definition that I gave below, we want to require that Qi double dot, the gravitational acceleration vector, which is given by 1 over Mi, gradient over I of V, this replaces the gravitational force, is once again is such that it points toward the center of mass C, and here we have the center of mass m1 q1 plus mn qn over the total mass C. So it points to C, and this is proportional to the distance of the center of mass. And this quantity lambda is a scalar function which is the same for all particles. So as you see, it does not depend on the index I. This is an important point. Okay, so which are the most celebrated central configurations? I was already mentioning before, but we don't have, keep in mind that we don't have just the triangular equilateral Lagrangian configurations. So here we have Sun, I just found on Scholarpedia, a picture with the, with not with Jupiter, but with the Earth, even better because we can generalize a 23 body system. So we have the equilateral triangular configuration, but we have also the collinear Euler Lagrange Euler collinear configurations for three bodies with L1 between the two primaries, L2 and L3 on the two sides of the primaries. Okay, so these are the classical central configurations which satisfy the following relation, that is Qi double dot is equal to minus lambda Qi minus C. And now I would like to make first a remark, which is extremely interesting. What happens to collisions when the bodies go to undergo a collision? So if you assume that all particles collide at the center of mass at time t equal to zero, and if you assume that the colliding particles behave as qi proportional to ai times t to the power to third, with ai being a vector constant, and the power to third can be proved, and I refer that it is in fact the right one, and I refer to this nice paper by Saari on central configurations, then at collision, they form a central configuration in the limit as t goes to zero. So when the bodies experience a collision, this is the first place where a central configuration appears. And this is proved by Siegel for triple collisions in the three-body problem, by Winter when n bodies collide at the center of mass, and by Saari for all possible kinds of collisions. But the fact that central configurations are extremely important is also made clear by the fact that Stephen Smale, one of the biggest scientists in dynamical systems and mathematical physics, inserted this problem as one of his list of problems for the 21st century. And the problem reads as, it is believed that for any value of n, n being the number of bodies, and any choices of the positive masses mj, there are only a finite number of central configurations. Is this true? Well, Euler and Lagrange already proved that when n equal to 3, when you have three bodies, you have just five central configurations, the three collinear and the two equilateral. Then Hampton and Meikle made a computer-assisted proof. Computer-assisted means that you make a proof, you need the computer to make the proof because it involves long computations, but you use the computer in a rigorous way. So controlling the errors introduced by the machine. If you want, I can give you more information at the end. Okay, so Hampton and Meikle proved that for n equal to 4, when you have four bodies, there are only a finite number of central configurations. And then Roberts proved that the necessary condition for having a finite number of relative equilibria is that the masses are positive. Since he proved that there are an infinite number, a continuous number of relative equilibria for n equal to 5, but this includes that at least there is one negative mass, which is not physically relevant. So for a continuous mass, you have to have this condition. So this is in summary some of the main results concerning central configurations. So what happens at collisions and what happens when you have a different number of bodies. But let me come back to our definition, the definition that I was introducing before as according to Meikle of central configuration. And let me come back to this quantity lambda because it plays an important role. And lambda can be determined, in fact, explicitly as follows. Just a few computations, very easy, because one is the translational invariance of the potential. Can be rephrased by saying that the sum of ri of the gradient with respect to I of v is equal to zero. Okay, these are a sum of partial derivatives. Take Mathematica, take the expression of v, compute the derivatives and check that this is true. Sum of ri of gradient of ri of v is equal to zero. On the other hand, I think you all know that the degree minus one homogeneity of the Newtonian potential gives that the sum of I of qi transpose gradient I of v is equal to minus v. These two relations lead to consider that we have the following expression, that the sum of I of qi minus c transposed times gradient of I of v is equal to minus v. Because C is a constant, so C times the sum of gradient IV is equal to zero. And sum of I of QI gradient of IV is equal to minus V. So this equation is true. And then we know that by definition of central configuration, we have this expression here. Therefore, if we multiply this expression by qi minus e transposed and sum up, we obtain that minus lambda mi qi minus e transposed times qi minus e is equal to minus v. But then we introduce I, which is the sum over I of mi, qi minus c transpose qi minus c, which is qi minus c square. And therefore we obtain that lambda is equal to v over I, where I, defined in this way, is the so-called moment of inertia with respect to c. So this is a simple computation which provides lambda in terms of v and I. Okay, and now we come to the geopotential expansion, which is another topic. It is important because as you see here, we know lambda, we know the central configuration, but now we have to specify what is V. So we need to spend a little bit of time on the expression for V. The standard form for the gravitational potential at distance r is the integral over the body B of the density rho, which depends on the coordinates, times g over r times the volume dx dy dz. And for a spherical body with a homogeneous density, we recover the standard form, that is v is equal to gm over r, where m is the overall mass of the body. But if the body is not oblate, we need to consider that v must satisfy the Laplace equation. That is the Laplacian of V, the sum of the second derivatives with respect to the coordinates, is equal to zero. So how do we find the solution to the Laplace equation? Well, an easy way is, in the standard way, is to consider spherical coordinates, say r, theta, c, to transform to the Cartesian coordinate to spherical coordinates and try to look for a solution in this form as a function phi, which is the product of three functions, and each function depends just on one spherical coordinate, gamma depending just on r, theta depending just on theta, and capital psi depending just on psi. So the spherical harmonic function, I say it is, these functions are called, will constructed in this way, and one can prove that the spherical harmonic functions have the following form. It is 1 over r to the n plus 1, which is the function gamma, times pnk of sine of theta, which is the function theta, because it depends just on theta, and then we have either cosine or sine of k psi, which is the function psi. And what is pnk? Pnk denotes this Legendre functions, which for completeness I recall, they are defined in this way as the derivatives of the Legendre polynomials Pn of x, where the Legendre polynomials are obtained in this way. Or you can have, usually I prefer to have a recursive formula, but for the Legendre polynomials, but this is enough for our purposes. Okay, so if we recast everything together, then we obtain that the gravitational potential can be expanded in this way, which contains the Keplerian potential gm over r, and then I split the expansion in two parts. One part is the gravitational potential with spherical harmonics pn0, so with the second index equal to zero, we will refer to this as the zonal terms, and a second part with k different from zero, so p and k, and coefficients c and k and s and k, and these are called the tesseral terms, while the coefficients of the first part are c to zero, okay, because if you take k equal to zero, this part is equal to zero, so you say to C20 will be equal to Jn0, or for short, Jn. So this is the general expansion of the gravitational potential. But then we ask ourselves, when and where can we use this expansion? The answer is given here. And now we need to introduce the Brillouin sphere. The Brillouin sphere is the sphere which circumscribes the body. Here is the asteroid Itokawa, we take the sphere which circumscribes the body, and then we can see that the spherical harmonic expansion that I gave at the previous slide is guaranteed to converge outside the Brillouin sphere. Inside the Brillouin sphere, the spherical harmonic expansion may be convergent or may be divergent. So we are led to the following comment that the previous expansion is called, in fact, the exterior gravity field expansion, since it is valid definitely and certainly outside the Brillouin sphere, except in some special cases for which I refer to dedicated literature, for example, Takahashi and Shears in Celestial Mechanics and Dynamical Astronomy 2014. Nevertheless, as many of the talks this week were definitely making clear, we are very often interested to proximity operations very close to the asteroid. So what happens when we go inside the Brillouin sphere? For example, in this sphere, which is a Brillouin sphere inside the, let's say, inside the close to the body and tangent, having the property that it is tangent to the body, in that case, we need to use an interior gravity field expansion, which is not valid outside the Brillouin sphere and which converges inside the Brillouin sphere. So we have, for your knowledge, we have an exterior gravity field, which is the one that I gave before, an interior gravity field expansion, for which I refer to this paper by Takahashi and Shears. But is this the only way to deal with the expansion of the gravitational potential and explicit expression for the gravitational potential? The answer is no. As you know also from previous talks, there are alternatives to exterior and interior gravity field expansion. I don't want to make I just want to quote these topics. I don't claim to be exhaustive. These topics would deserve specific lectures on itself. I just want to mention that we could use a polyhedral gravity field expansion, which consists in rebuilding the shape of the body through tetrahedral polyhedrons, which converges anywhere around the body, even the surface, but it is normally computational heavy and assumes a non-density distribution. Or we could also use the mass concentration or mass con model, in which a body with a given shape is approximated by the mass cons, so a set of point masses packed so to reproduce the distribution of the object mass, which is simpler to compute, but inaccurate near this, typically inaccurate near to the surface of the body. I want also to mention that instead of the interior exterior spherical harmonic expansion, one could use the ellipsoidal harmonic expansion. That is, instead of the Brillouin sphere, which is the sphere that circumscribes the body, you could build the Brillouin ellipsoid. The Brillouin ellipsoid is the smallest ellipsoid that circumscribes the asteroid, like in these pictures which are taken by the paper by Romain and Barriot, again on Celestial Mechanics and Dynamical Astronomy 2001. This is a very nice expansion. It's a uniformly convergent outside the smallest ellipsoid, and you see that you gain a lot of space. But the formulae are, as it is obviously clear, they are more complicated. I don't want also here to give the complete treatment of this topic, but I want just to let you know that it exists. The formulae are here. If you denote by ABC the semi-axis of a reference ellipsoid and introduce the quantities rho mu ni in this way, where Q1, Q2, Q3 are the cubic roots, are the roots of this cubic polynomial, then you can expand the potential, gravitational potential, in terms of sphere ellipsoidal harmonic expansions. And this with the coefficients alpha and k, but instead of the functions the Legendre polynomials, here you find different functions, F and D, which are called the Lemma functions of first and second kind, and which satisfy the Lemma equation. So this is, as you see, more complex, but it would deserve, in my opinion, a really a nice investigation because it is very promising. Now we have all the ingredients to start with our four-body problem with oblate primaries. So we assume that we have the four bodies. Hector is not spherical. Its shape is approximated by a potato, a dumbbell, whatever you want, with an equivalent radius equal to 92 kilometers. What is the equivalent radius? The radius of a sphere with the same volume of the asteroid. So it is 92 kilometers. The inclination is not zero, but we will consider the three primaries on the same plane, and that they will form a central configuration that I will give in a moment. The moonless Scamandrius orbits Hector at the distance of about 957 kilometers. Its inclination is different from zero, so about 50 degrees. So we will consider not the planar problem. Then we know that this is the mass of the Sun, the mass of Jupiter, and the mass of Hector is 9 orders of magnitude smaller. And finally, this one is the Sun-Jupiter distance. Okay, these are data. With this data, we compute which are the forces on Scamandrius. And this is a nice picture showing the distance, the forces according to the distance from the center of Hector. And the dashed line is the orbit of Scamandrius. So you see the major force is the Keplerian attraction of Hector, followed by the J2 potential, and then followed by Sun and Jupiter. So we need to consider all these forces to get a reliable model. And now, why do we consider second order? What does it mean that we consider second order zonal harmonic? It means that in the gravitational potential that I was mentioning before, we just retain the J2 coefficient. So we have the Keplerian part, Jm over R, and then we have the J2 coefficient, where here I made explicit the Legendre polynomial of order 2. So 3/2 z over R squared minus 1/2. Okay, so what is J2 for Hector? This is an important point because we want to know its value. Well, this is an exercise that I usually do to my students in the courses of celestial mechanics or classical mechanics. If you have an ellipsoid with a semi-major axis ABC, there is this formula here, which gives the explicit expression for J2. And if you put inside the data for Hector, you find that J2 is 0.47, which is a large value, in fact, because for comparison, J2 for the Earth is of the order of 10 to the minus 3. So definitely we cannot assume that J2 is, Hector is a spherical body. Okay. So once we are convinced with this, we are led to consider which are the central configurations for three bodies. And we want now to take the bodies to be oblate. And okay, so now this is a more technical part, or better, more mathematical part. If you want to just disconnect your mind for 5 minutes, you're allowed to do it, but then please reconnect. Because I want now to show you that the central configurations are not the equilateral central configurations. And this comes out from this computation. Once again, I summarize here the gravitational potential for each body Vi with masses Mi. And now we consider all three bodies. Given that we make an effort to find the central configuration for one oblate body, Hector, we do it for all bodies. So we consider three different coefficients, C20i or J2i. And this is the same as J2. Okay, and from now on, I will put the gravitational constant equal to 1. Then I will also consider planar, the central configuration of the three major bodies, Hector, Sun, and Jupiter, on planar orbits. So z is equal to 0. So this term here is equal to 0, and we have this potential here, vi equal to the Keplerian part, and then mi ci over r cube, where ci is this constant here, 1/2 ri square c20i, which is negative because the c2i's are negative. We consider also cij tilde as the sum of ci plus cj, qi the position vectors, and this allows us to consider the following equations of motion, where we have once again the Keplerian part and the part due to the oblateness. This is the main part, and then we want to rewrite this equation in a more compact form. So we introduce rij, which is qi minus qj, bold q, which is q1, q2, q3, bold m, which is the diagonal matrix, 6x6 diagonal matrix, having on the mean diagonal two copies of each bus, m1, m1, m2, m2, m3, m3, and with this you can rewrite the equations of motion as mq equal to the gradient of u, where u is the potential that I was given before, which is the potential for the three bodies with oblate masses. But now we want to find the central configuration for this problem, and therefore we need to make this computation. First of all, we assume that the center of mass is fixed at the origin, so mq is equal to zero. Then we are interested in relative equilibrium solutions for the three body problems, which are characterized by the fact that they become equilibrium points in a uniformly rotating frame. So we change coordinates as q of t is equal to a function gamma of omega t times z of t. Gamma is a new function, is a 6x6 rotation matrix for some omega, we'll specify omega later. Okay, and then mq dot equal to gradient of u, the equation of motion can be rewritten as gradient of u plus omega square mz equal to zero. And then a solution z of the three body problem satisfying this equation of motion is a central configuration, since this equation is equivalent to say that zi double dot is equal to minus omega square zi, which means that the accelerations are proportional to the position vector endpoint to the center of mass. If we introduce, as before, the moment of inertia, rewriting it as in these coordinates as z transposed mz, first of all, one can show that this quantity is constant, so it is equal to I bar for all times, and then setting f of z equal to u of z plus 1/2 omega square I of z minus I bar, and using the fact that the gradient of I, which is defined here, is obviously equal to 2mz, then the equation for the central configuration can be rewritten as gradient u equal to omega gradient u plus omega square mz equal to zero. This is the equation that I was writing before. This equation is equivalent to solve the following Lagrange multiplier problem, that is the gradient f equal to zero with the condition that I of z minus I bar is equal to zero. In fact, if you take the gradient of this function, you obtain gradient of u plus omega square gradient I, but gradient I is 2mz, so 2 and 2 cancel out, mz equal to zero. So this is, so we end up with the fact that we need to solve this Lagrange multiplier problem. And if we write explicitly this equation here, we end up with three equations which has exactly the same form. 1 over rij cube minus 3 times a constant over rij to the 5 equal to omega square. And then we just change the indexes, with the constraint that the moment of inertia should be equal to I bar. And then we have to solve these equations. And we need to study the dependence of these equations on the unique solution Rij. But these equations are of this form. 1 over r cube minus 3 over c over r to the 5 equal to c square, omega square. And then if you study this equation as a function of r, it is and c, it is easy to show that it has a unique solution. And besides, dr over dc is given by this expression, which is negative, because it is minus r over r squared minus 5c. Remind that c is negative. So this is a negative quantity, so r is a decreasing function of c. But if r is a decreasing function of c, when you have your ordering of the quantity c, recalling that you have C2, you obtain that C2 is less or equal than C1, less or equal than C3, and then there is an ordering of also the quantities C tilde, and which means an ordering of the distances. So R13 is less or equal than R23, less or equal than R12. And this leads to the proof of the following proposition. In the three-body problem, with all bodies of blade, for every fixed value of the moment of inertia, say I bar, there exists a unique central configuration, which is in general a scalene triangle. Moreover, the body with a larger CI is opposite to the longer side of the triangle. And then we have also the following corollary, that is, if only one body is oblate, so if, for example, M Hector is only oblate, so you have C1 to 0 equal to C2I 0 equal to 0, so the oblateness of Saturn and Jupiter are equal to 0, then you have an isosceles triangle because R13 is equal to R23. And this is something that, in fact, is very interesting in itself from the also from the theoretical point of view. And now we come to the last part, because this allows us to give now the, well, before giving the Hamiltonian of the four-body problem, we need to give the location of the three bodies in this triangular central configurations. Okay, now we need to make some other computations. So we take the synodic reference frame, rotating with the angular velocities of the primaries. We put the mass m1 on the x-axis, on the negative side, so y1 will be equal to 0. Instead of normalizing the moment of inertia, we normalize r12 equal to 1. We call, simplicity of notation, r13 equal to u and r23 equal to v. And then we introduce this quantity, w, which is 1 plus u squared minus v squared. And then we have the following, one can prove in the paper with, as it is done in the paper with Burgos, Garcia, Guidea, Lam, and Galesh, we have the following proposition. In the synodic reference frame, the coordinates of the three bodies in the general triangular central configurations, satisfying these constraints, that is, the one distance is normalized to one, then the other two are u squared and v squared. The center of mass is in the origin. The masses, the sum of these masses are normalized to one. The primary P1, the sun is on the x-axis. Then the coordinates are given by these expressions. Okay, don't want that you compute them. We cannot prove it. It's a matter of computation, but I would like to just emphasize that you can give an explicit expression for the coordinates of the three bodies, Sun, x1, y1, Jupiter, x2, y2, Hector, x3, y3, in terms of the masses and the distances. And you can give it in the general triangular central configuration, not necessarily the equilateral one. Okay, so these are the coordinates, again, corollary or remark. When none of the bodies is oblate, the standard computation by Lagrange, you obtain the equilateral triangular central configuration with all distances equal to one. So this leads to the final part, that is the Hamiltonian of the four-body problem with oblate primaries. And the Hamiltonian is obtained mimicking the computation which is normally done for the equilateral Lagrangian configurations. That is, we take the synodic reference frame with the three heavy bodies and an infinitesimal mass. And the coordinates of the infinitesimal mass are given by these equations of motion. X double dot minus 2 omega y dot is equal to d omega tilde over dx. Then we have the equation for y, the equation for z. And what is the potential, the effective potential omega tilde? The effective potential is given by the centrifugal part, 1 half omega square times x square plus y square. And then we have the Keplerian part, mi over ri, and the part which is given by the oblateness. And look here, we have the oblateness for all bodies. So C2I0, this is the most general form of the effective potential, and retaining only the second order potential, but of course you can truncate your expansion at any order. It is convenient, so first of all, what is omega? The angular velocity omega can be shown to be equal to the square root of 1 minus 3 times this quantity C, which depends on spherical harmonic coefficients of the bodies. And then it is convenient also to rescale time in such a way that the mean motion is normalized to 1, which means to consider these equations with the new effective potential omega, which is given by the following expressions, which is, you see that there is no more omega square here, but omega square is here. So these are the equations of motion. And now to obtain the Hamiltonian function, we do the standard computations. That is, we introduce the momenta conjugated to x, y, z as px, py, pz, which are given by x dot minus y, y dot plus x, and z dot. We pass to these symplectic coordinates, x, y, z, px, py, plus z, which are relative to the symplectic form omega, which is in Darboux form, x, which px, plus y, which pi, py, plus z, which pz. And finally, making the little computations, so you will find that the Hamiltonian function is given by this expression or this expression here. So this is just to I will put the slide on the web. So this you immediately obtain this expression, and then with a little bit of algebraic reduction, you obtain this expression, which is a Hamiltonian function, 1 half px squared plus py squared plus pyz squared, and then we have the Coriolis part, ypx minus xpy, and then we have the gravitational potential, the gravitational part, Keplerian and oblateness. And you see that we end up with an expression with 3 degrees of freedom, Hamiltonian degrees, non-autonomous, it does not depend explicitly on time, and it is 3 degrees, Hamiltonian 3 degrees of freedom. Okay, so this will be the starting point of the second part by Katalin Galesh. I come now to the last part, last section, that is, Katalin will take this Hamiltonian as starting point for the restricted four-body problem with 3 oblate objects where the oblate bodies are in a central configuration of general type. Then, as he will explain, I would like just to say a few words. He will perform a Hill approximation of the equations of motion describing the dynamics of the infinitesimal body, Scamandros, or a spacecraft in the vicinity of Hector, and derive the equilibrium points and study their linear stability. So I leave him to give more details in his lecture in the afternoon. I just want to conclude here that there are several perspectives for this study. We could analyze other Trojan asteroids around L4 and L5. We could obtain realistic physical models for the gravitational potential of asteroids with the regular shapes. As I was mentioning before, we cannot just confine our computations to the spherical harmonic expansion. We could use also the elliptic harmonic expansion. Even more, we can study what some of us have done for space debris And this is in fact an ongoing work that we are doing with Jaime, Marian, Willem, and Catalin. And that is the study of gravitational resonances for satellites orbiting irregularly shaped rotating bodies. So it is plenty of topics that we could do in the future. And let me conclude, since 4 minutes to left, and I would like to leave some time for questions. Let me conclude with showing the main references. Let me say that the parent paper is definitely this one by Jaime Burgos Barcia and Marian Guidea, Hill's Approximation in a Restricted Four-Body Problem in Celestial Mechanics and Dynamical Astronomy 2015, from which we generalized to the case of oblate bodies, and then the webpage by Rick Mikkel on Scholarpedia. And if you want to know more about gravitational expansions, I quoted before a couple of papers on celestial mechanics, or this one by Raymond and Bauer, which gives a comparison between spherical and ellipsoidal harmonic expansions. So I stop here, and thank you very much for your attention.